And to play this kind of music at these tempos and with some of the techniques that I didn't know was like the learning curve was ridiculous.
Right.
And the first 3 weeks here in LA, I was being taught by a teacher. She knew I was learning for a film, but her approach was more to teach me how to play. Yeah. And there were days where I thought, I've got it, I can do this, and I felt achievable. And there were days where I was completely discouraged. Because there would be moments where she'd be like, well, it's that note. And I'm like, wait, I actually don't know that note. It's very frustrating, but it was great because it instilled all these fundamentals for me. And when I got to Barcelona, I was able to sort of put it into the context of how I would then transpose all that into the sort of filmic approach, if you will.
Now normally when one trains on the piano, it's obviously it lasts many years.
It's a lifelong journey.
So you might start with scales and then you master the next level. I know nothing about piano, so I can't take you through that. But what was, obviously that wasn't the objective here. So you had a very specific goal in mind. What was the training house of design?
Partially, the reason why I didn't start practicing earlier, taking lessons for this earlier, was because the film, from the moment that my character sits down at the piano until he leaves the stage to find John Cusack, all of that was pre-rendered in animatic. It had to be, because the music, all of the action adheres to a strict time code, and all of that music had to be sort of basically pre-rendered prior to going to shoot. Because it's all timed out, and everything's timed out with the camera movements. So all of that was predetermined. So I got the music 3 weeks prior to going to Barcelona, because that's when it was all kind of finished and locked within the context of the animatic. Then I was provided.
Wait, sorry, does that mean that they were continuing to tweak the compositions as they were?
No, the basic framework for the composition was finished. What it was then as to what it is now is different.
So why did the animatics have to be done for you to start learning the compositions?
Specifically because I needed to know when I would be seen on camera playing.
I see.
And that animatic provided the very specific roadmap. So once that was finished, Eugenio sent me an email with, like, okay, this is the breakdown. These are the shots that you'll be on camera. So these are the specific, you know, bar 25 to 60 in this particular song. You need to know this. And so that kind of became what I needed. That was the process. Like, understanding, okay, so there's...
Wow.
Yeah, and I know when it's not. Because my double Hector was also my teacher in Barcelona. He has fingernails and I don't. and I can just tell.
Was it ever your hands in the close-ups?
Sometimes. But if it's over the shoulders onto my hands and you're not seeing a reflection of me, it's not me. But apparently it's like somewhere between 80% and 85%.
It's funny.
I'm kind of saying that.
It's amazing. And obviously there's always trickery like that in making a film. It's often shocking how often the character that you're looking at is not the actor.
Yeah.
You know, in a film there's stand-ins and doubles. But it seems like you have some particular, you're drawn to these sort of deconstructionist films from the actor's perspective. So I kept thinking of Maniac while I was watching this because, you know, to tell the story of Maniac, you know, Elijah is mostly shot from his character's point of view, and you appear briefly here and there in reflections and in certain meta moments where the camera comes out of the character, but you were meant to shoot only, what, 5 days or something?
It was supposed to be it was supposed to be 10 days or something.
Okay, and then Elijah learned that. He said, well, how are you doing my hands? Like, who's doing my voice? It was going to be Waller, right? It's our partner who's got big, hairy hands and a tattoo. Like,
Waller emailed me. He's like, hey, would it be weird if I'm your double for Maniac? And I was like, actually, it kind of is. Yeah. I don't understand. You have a big tattoo, and your hands are much larger than mine. You're an ex-Marine. I don't understand.
So Elijah then would remain on set for this entire shoot of Maniac, and it's his hands, and he was always there providing the voice for the other actors. You mensch. But again, here, again, there's this funny disconnect with the hands and the...
Oh, that's funny.
Yeah, so, I don't know, what is it with you and hands? I don't know what that means. So, similarly...
it's very technical, too.
Extremely technical, yeah. So, now, was there... like a guiding track for you on set? Okay, so if we were to actually hear and record a genuine recording of your performance, how good would it be?
It wouldn't be very good.
Okay. Because it appears that you're striking every note. I mean, are you in fact, I mean, I don't
know. I would say that the beginning of La Cinquette is probably the closest note for note that I got. Because it is so specific and it's quite slow, so that was the piece that I learned the most. I couldn't play it perfectly, but it was roughly there. A lot of it came down to geography and timing and rhythm, most of the time. And you know, for one shot, if the camera's looking at me, well, here or there, from your perspective, and my pinky is hitting this key, as long as that pinky is hitting that key at the right time, effectively, and the hands are moving in the right way, it looks accurate. So it's things like that.
Got it.
For the most part.
Got it.
But so we had a track there on the day. I mean, I've never worked on a more technical movie in my life. It literally felt every day. Like I said, everything was adhering to this animatic. So instead of getting a call sheet, like we never shot anything with traditional coverage. Like all of those scenes, all the musical scenes, are single shots. So there's no masters, there's no coverage. It's a shot that leads to another shot that leads to another shot, and so on. And so on a daily basis, our call sheets would be, instead of like scene 15 for the day, it would be scene 15, shot number, and then the corresponding musical piece, bar 125 to 150, for each shot. And then on the back of the call sheet, we would have pictures correlating to the images from the animatic. So it was super technical, but it was also really easy to understand. And so every day, we were literally like finishing shots of the movie and then cutting them into the animatic as we were going along.
Wow.
And then I was listening. Sorry.
No, please.
And then on set, there was a master track that would play over a PA for the orchestra. The orchestra was also playing loud. In my ear, I would listen to the isolated piano track so that I was able to discern, because sometimes it would get lost within the orchestral parts. And then also John Cusack's voice.
Well, wow, so that was my next question. So he was really feeding...
We shot all of his stuff in the first week, and then he recorded all of the dialogue in a day, and then they cut it into the animatic, and then into the audio track.
So were you ever interacting with him in real time, or were you interacting with the recording of him?
I was interacting with the recording.
So there was no improv? And was it a functioning piano?
Get it right, I would know how it was right.
Mm-hmm. But you're not. But you weren't actually making music. And this, by the way, is how Justin Timberlake's concerts are.
but in practicing, it was something that I needed. Like it's your ear is your reference constantly. But it's the thing that will fuck you up if you fuck up. Like, I fucked up, and then you'll stop and realize you have to start over again. So they muted the piano, and initially I was afraid of that, because I was used to my ear being my guide, but it would have totally screwed me at the end. So it was a good thing that it was muted. I was able to be a lot freer and not having to worry about being, you know, perfect.
Right. But so was most of your prep, I mean, you know, usually the night before, at the end of a shoot day, an actor is kind of going over the sides for the next day and the dialogue, but it sounds like you were probably more preparing for the particular bars that you
for the most part, yeah.
Yeah, which is feeds very perfectly into the situation that your character is
totally
in.
It was very, my experience making it was kind of mirrored to what the character was experiencing, because it was petrifying.
Yeah.